We as a church, if you're new with us and you just kind of joined us, we talked about three components that God uses to really launch our faith into where it needs to be last weekend. And those three things that God gives us in his word in Matthew 6 are prayer, fasting, and generosity. And so we talked about those things last weekend, but can I tell you, many of us have decided to fast, and what fasting is us just really trying to draw ourselves closer to God, to remember what he has done in our life and to remember what he says he's going to do in our life. And we as a church started a fast together, and if you're not on that fast with us, we're fasting for 21 days, and some of us are about, you know, 6 days into that fast. We started on Tuesday. Anybody on the fast with me today? Huh? Raise your hand, a couple of you guys. That's awesome. Anybody feeling a little bit lighter on their feet today because they've been fasting for about a week now? It's amazing. The first 3 days become very difficult. And then, you know, after that, you begin to kind of draw in and remember what it's all about. And again, fasting doesn't make you, you know, more significant than the other person. It's just simply a way for you to draw closer to God and for him to begin to inspire your faith in a powerful, powerful way. And we've been doing that, and we're going to continue to do that. We have some goals together as a church we're trying to accomplish. And if you would want to see those, there's some information about those on your way out today. You can grab one of those sheet of paper. It says fasting on it. It has some of the things we're praying together about as a church. And so you can grab that and join us, because we can do more together than we can do apart, can't we, huh? And so we're honored you're here today. And today I want to kind of talk to you a little bit about inspiring your faith and inspiring your faith with a solid hope. And I do know that many of us have just made some New Year's resolutions. That's kind of what we do in January a lot of times. And New Year and January 1st is a great time to hit the reset button, to refocus, to begin to calibrate our life in such a way and head it in a direction that we want to head it in. And many of you have made resolutions. I hope you can keep them in 2017 if you didn't keep them in 2016. And you know, New Year's is just a great time to do that. And that's really why we have chose to fast this year in 2017, is to get things in order correctly from the front and then begin to let God do amazing things in our life. Now, I do believe that one of the greatest things any one of us can ever discover in our life is who our Creator is, and not only who our Creator is, but begin to understand who he says that we are. I believe that, you know, God created you and God created me and the person sitting around you and the next person for a grand purpose and for a unique purpose. The Bible even says that God knit you together in your mother's womb. And so God's desire is for human beings to be positioned to live out their purpose in life. And, you know, he has ways for us to be positioned correctly, and then he begins to motivate us to live out our purpose. And I hope to do that with his word today, to not only create an environment where you begin to get yourself positionally right with the Creator, but you become functionally right with the Creator. It's one thing to understand who you are positionally. It takes it to another level when you can understand who you are functionally as a human being. And today we're going to talk about both of those things, because God's desire is for us to function in life as he has designed us to function in life. But a lot of times many of us are frustrated and we don't function as he would desire for us to function, because maybe we've just kind of put some things in the back of the closet and we're missing at life, and God wants to unveil those things this weekend for you and I to do exactly what he desires for us to do. So I'm glad you came this weekend, because I believe God's going to speak to you in a powerful, powerful way. We have any golfers in the house today? We live in the golfing capital of the East Coast, or whatever they call it, right? Any golfers? Raise your hand if you're a golfer in the house today. Fantastic. Awesome golfers. Many of you are golfers. Some of you are like me. You are a wannabe golfer. You used to want to be a golfer, and now you're a frustrated golfer, so no longer you're a wannabe golfer because you became frustrated whenever you wanted to be a golfer, and maybe you did like me. You took your clubs and you put them in the back of the garage or in the closet somewhere, and now those clubs are basically antiques. I know some of y'all are knocking on my clubs up here today in my little Spalding bag and stuff and all, but I need you to understand, this is an antique, okay? This thing goes back, way back. And the clubs inside of it have been bought along the journey, but, and I bought these clubs when I wanted to be a golfer probably, I don't know, some, maybe even 30 years ago now. I said 20, but I think it's probably more like 30. Maybe even longer than that, probably like 35. I'm getting older by the month. But I wanted to be a golfer, and I haven't played golf but a couple of times since I've been in North Myrtle Beach, though it's the golfing capital of the world. And I got clubs. I mean, I know there's some more modern clubs now and all that sort of stuff, but I got some, you know. But if the truth of it is, I played a couple of times, but if you ask me to go play golf with you, I'm probably going to say no. And it's not because I don't want to be with you or hang out with you. It's simply because I'm a frustrated golfer and I'm embarrassed to go with you. Because I'm telling you, I'm terrible. Like when I swing the club, like all I hear sometimes over the top of the ball is, and you know what? That's exactly why I got frustrated. Because I would miss the ball, and then what would happen is my friends I went with, they would laugh at me, and I became embarrassed, and I didn't have support around me. And, you know, I just kind of like gave up on the game, was embarrassed, frustrated, because I'm like, you know, I'm not going to get out there and just continue to mess up. I don't know how to get it right. And so I need some coaching. So I'm real insecure when it comes to the golf game. And I would try some more. And, you know, what would happen is I would try harder. They're like, you know, just try to hit the ball. So I try. And then the next swing wouldn't go over the top. It would basically hit about a foot behind the ball, and dirt would go like flying like 8 foot. And I would make contact occasionally and hit it pretty hard, but it would never go in the right direction. I'd put it pretty hard in the woods. And I figured something out. When I went to play golf, it cost me more for the golf balls than it did to pay to play the round of golf, because I would lose so many golf balls in the game. So I just gave it up, put my antique clubs in the back of the garage, and you know, that's where they pretty well stay now. And I was thinking about this a little bit. That's really why some of us never fulfill our potential in life. Because we've become frustrated. Maybe somebody laughed at you when you missed at something in your life, and they told you to try harder and get it right. And maybe you tried even some religious stuff for a while. You tried a little harder. You tried to do the right things a little bit harder, but the more you tried and you didn't really have extreme coaching in your life, or you didn't have someone alongside of you to encourage you, what you did is you just kind of gave up on the game and said, well, I guess this is the way it is, and so life has just got to be this way, and so I'm just going to be frustrated for the rest of my life. You know, a lot of people don't fulfill their potential because of something simple as insecurity. Not realizing their position and not realizing their function. And my friends, God wants to position every single one of us in an incredible place. But he doesn't only want to position us in an incredible place. He wants us to function as he has designed us to function. And here's the good news, is he's not like my friends on the golf course that just laughs at you when you miss the ball or when you miss at life. He's a God that embraces you and says, hey, I want to come alongside of you. And you know what? I want to coach you to greatness and help you become everything I've created you to be. He's a good, good father. He's an amazing God. And see, what happens a lot of times, we laugh at one another when we miss. We try to always get above the other person. But God's not like that. God's a God that comes alongside of us and really helps us achieve perfection to this game called life. I wrote this in my journal this week as I was preparing to give this message. And I was thinking a little bit about it. And I wrote this down, and I think this is a profound concept and statement, and I just want to do it at the beginning of this message today because I think a lot of us positionally are struggling, but I want to say this to all of us today. Life isn't about achieving perfection alone. It's about walking with perfection and learning from Him each and every day. Life is not about achieving perfection alone. It's about walking with Him each and every day and achieving perfection with someone. And so, you know, the Bible tells us in one of the greatest talks ever given to humanity, it's called the Sermon on the Mount. It's found in your Bible from Matthew 5 to Matthew 7. I like to call it the Talk on the Hill. It's where Jesus gave the greatest speech to humanity ever to help them understand who He is so that they could understand who they are and begin to live life on purpose and basically hit some hole-in-ones with their life. The sermon is wrapped around who He is, who they are, and then how they can really begin to live life and function in a way that He has designed them to live life. But He says something amazing in the middle of this message in Matthew 5, verse 48, and I want you to grab hold of it today. He says, you are to be perfect even as your Father in heaven is perfect. You are to be perfect even as your Father in heaven is perfect. And if you're listening to Jesus give the talk on the hill, you're like, come on, man. I mean, are you kidding me? And some of us are sitting here today and say, that's impossible for me to be perfect as my Heavenly Father is perfect. That's impossible to achieve in life. But you got to understand contextually what Jesus is saying in context here. What he's saying is, listen, if you begin to grab hold of who I am and who you are and begin to position yourself as I would have you to be positioned and begin to listen to my authority in your life, you will begin to take some strokes off of your game and begin to achieve perfection as your Heavenly Father is perfect in heaven. He's saying you have the opportunity to really become better at this game called life. Wow. So how do we do it? First and foremost, we have to get positioned correctly. And the Bible tells us in Romans chapter 3, it says this, as the writer wrote to the church at Rome. It says, God has shown us a way to be made right with Him without keeping the requirements of the law, as was promised in the writings of Moses and the prophets long ago. Now this is amazing, because what it says is God has now shown us a way to be in right standing with Him, positioned right with Him, as the prophets and the law of Moses pointed to long ago. Can I tell you something? God never intended for people to be made right by the law. He only intended the law to show people that, you know what, they were missing at life. Missing the mark of His glorious standard. And I need you to grab hold of what that is, missing the mark, not hitting hole-in-ones with your life. That thing is called sin. That's what sin is missing the mark of God's glorious standard for your life. And so God wants us to understand that we have missed. He put the law in place. It's impossible for us to achieve perfection by the law. But what the law was to do was to show us that we needed someone to come alongside of us so that we could achieve perfection. Now pay close attention. It continues to say there in Romans, it says, we are made right with God, not by keeping the law, but by placing our faith in one who fulfilled the law, and his name is Jesus Christ. Everybody say faith. So our faith, our confident hope that something will actually happen, our faith, the way to be made right with God positionally is by what? Putting our faith in his gift of grace, his name is Jesus Christ. That's how you become positionally right with God to accomplish his purpose for your life. And then it goes on to say, and this is true for everyone who believes, no matter who we are. Wow. It says it's true for everyone. That means the person sitting beside you today, it's as true for them as it is for you. It's as true for me as it is for you. No matter how bad I am at the game, no matter how many shots I've missed in life, no matter how bad my misses are or my sin is, but the Bible says, you know what, that we all have this opportunity to be positioned right with God, and it's simply by putting our faith, our trust, our belief, our heart in that God has made a way to be made right with him and right standing with him. And it's by sending his one and only son, Jesus, to pay a price that we couldn't pay. The Bible calls this grace, undeserved favor. And you know, if you want to really, really achieve what the designer designed for you to achieve, the first and foremost thing you got to do is get in the right position. And that only comes by putting your faith in Jesus Christ, is what the Bible says. Now, some of us are frustrated with life because we're like, okay, I understand that. I know what you're saying, but I gotta try harder to get better. I gotta try harder. And what's interesting is, when we put our faith in Jesus Christ, we don't have to try harder. All we have to do is listen more. And it's great news because it's not about trying more for perfection. It's about allowing perfection to be made for you and then him coming alongside of you and coaching you to greatness. The Bible goes on to say there in Romans 3, it says, now, we all have the opportunity to put our faith in Jesus Christ, but it says there in Romans 3:23, for everyone has missed, everyone has sinned. Everyone. We all fall short of God's glorious standard. Let me put it in our analogy today, the golf analogy. We've all sliced the ball. At one time or another, we've all sliced the ball. And we've missed the mark of knocking hole in ones. Can I tell you, Jesus is the perfect one, and he begins to really hit hole in ones on every hole. He's a par golfer, below par golfer. He can really do it every single time, but the Bible says that we've all sinned. We all fall short of his standard. We can't do that. Yet God, with undeserved kindness, declares that we are righteous. He did this through Jesus Christ when he freed us from the penalty of our sins. For God presented Jesus as the sacrifice for our sin. People are made right with God when they believe that Jesus sacrificed his life, shedding his blood. So, how do we get positioned right to live out our purpose in life, to function right? The only way to be positioned right, the Bible is clear, is to put your faith in what God paid for on a cross through the blood of Jesus. And once you do that, you are positioned right with God's undeserved favor to begin for his favor to unleash on you, for you to become everything he has created you to be. And you know what? There's some of us today that need to get positioned right. Because all we're trying to do is we're trying to please God more when God says, would you receive what I'd offered for you to get positioned right. There's others of us that we have been positioned right, but we're still frustrated. And I'm going to talk to that in just a few moments of maybe why why we're frustrated as even being positioned right and made right with God, because we have believed and put our faith in the finished work of Christ. But before I get there today, I really want to draw this as clear as I know how to draw it today, because I think this can change your life. And the only way I can really think to illustrate it today about your position is this. There's this game in golf. And for you folks who aren't golfers, I'm going to explain the game. I'm not a golfer, but I understand the game. And I understand how it works. And so if you're not a golfer, I'm going to explain. But when I say it, you know, maybe some of you, it's going to click for you what it means to be positioned right in Christ Jesus. But this game is called best ball. Best ball. And basically what best ball is in the golf game is you team up with maybe a team of four people, and you all tee off and you begin to try to knock the ball in the hole. And as you tee off, no matter if you're like me and you're a frustrated golfer, or a wannabe golfer, and you catch air, or you know, you hit behind the ball and your ball dribbles like 8 feet. If you're playing best ball, the good news is you get to move your ball to the best shot on the team and then begin to advance and take another stroke. In other words, the best player on the team, the professional, the more perfect player, the one that does it the best, you get to take your ball and move it to where their ball is and continue to try to play the game. Can I tell you that? That's what putting your faith in Jesus is a lot like. It's like playing best ball. What God is saying is, listen, I hit the ball perfect every time. Why don't you team up with me? It's not about you achieving perfection, but it's about you coming alongside of the one who has achieved perfection and knocked it out of the park, and you have the opportunity to take your life and put it where my life is and move forward. Best ball. And all of us have the opportunity to play life with Jesus. And even if we've missed and we are a wannabe golfer, now we have the opportunity to move our life to what he did by living a perfect life here on earth and then begin to advance in what he's created us to do. He forgave us of our misses, of our sin, our separation from God. And the moment you believe in the grace of God and what Jesus came to do for you, to allow you to be righteous because of his life, then is the moment that God begins to open the door for you to begin to be coached in life to become everything he's created you to be. Best ball. It's amazing. And, you know, but most of us, we come to church and we think that the Christian life is just about forgiveness and, hey, you know what, I'm just going to be a frustrated golfer. I'll go out and play with you guys and, you know, I'm just going to move my ball and I'm not even going to take a try at it. You know, if Jesus forgave me, I'm just going to move my life to where he is and just accept it for where it is. Can I tell you, God didn't create you to be that way. God created you to win. God created you to take strokes off of your game. God created you for significance. And yes, we can, no matter how bad we've missed, how much we've sinned, we can take our life and have the righteousness of Christ. But grace is so much more than just receiving forgiveness. Grace is actually the empowering agent of God to help you hit some hole-in-ones with your life. So how does grace operate? Grace forgives us through the person of Jesus Christ, but grace also is what we access through Jesus Christ. And the Bible says when Jesus died on the cross, there was a veil in the temple that basically where humans were separated from God, and that veil split from top to bottom because of what Jesus did on a cross. And can I tell you, that represents this, that Jesus forgave sin. No longer does humanity have to be separated from the voice of God in their life, but you can put your faith in Jesus Christ and you can access your heavenly Father every single day, every single moment, and he will tell you which club to pull out of that bag to swing the next stroke. So best ball is great. But God would be a terrible coach if all he said is, hey, you missed. Just move your life to me because I hit. Yeah, that's what God says. Hey, I'm not going to condemn you because you missed. I'm not going to laugh at you like your friends. I'm not going to point your finger. But hey, bro, I want you to hit the ball occasionally and get some hole-in-ones. And so God's not like, hey, we're going to play best ball. Just move it here every time and just continue to be a loser with your life. No, we're going to perfect this thing. We're going to crank it up. We're going to get you in shape as a kingdom citizen to golf as I've desired for you to golf, to play the game of life as I desire for you to play the game of life. How awesome would it be if you hit a cool shot every now and then and everybody else had the opportunity to move their ball to your advancement? See, it's interesting because God is an amazing, amazing God that doesn't only want you to be forgiven. He wants to coach you to greatness. And the difference between being coached to greatness and not being coached to grace is first and foremost putting yourself in the right position through what Christ has done, but then functioning in the way that God desires for you to function. And basically what works against us in that is most of us, you know, we think we know how to golf without the coach in our life. I know how to do it. I'm just going to keep on swinging. I'm just going to keep on missing. I mean, I hear people say that to me all the time. Hey, bro, there's no way I can knock any hole in ones. I'm just a sinner. All I can do is just keep on sinning. Really? You can be forgiven for every one of your sins forever and ever and ever. But my friend, you don't have to keep missing in areas of your life, because God came to deliver you from the penalty of sin and give you the power to coach you how to hit some hole-in-ones with your life. You don't have to keep on sinning every day. You choose to do it. And the only reason we choose it and I choose it is because instead of trusting what God has said, I kind of shrink back to my old rebellious nature and trust what I think. And I want to encourage you today, if you want to hit some hole-in-ones in life, the secret is submission to the authority over you. Now, I know the moment I said that word, you thought, I'm not going to submit to anybody. Why is that? It's because we've all sinned and missed the mark of God's glorious standard. Our human nature gives God pushback, gives each other pushback, and we have kind of this rebellion in our heart. You say, well, nah, I'm not rebellious, really. I'll give you an example. We seated you when we walked you in today. And we put you in a seat. And the reason we did that is simply to get you in a place to build community with others. But some of us thought, I don't want to sit in that seat. They're not going to tell me where to sit. I'm going to sit where I want to sit. So that just proves that we want to do what we want to do and not what someone else suggests that we do. And though that's a small scale, that's really what we do with God a lot of times. And by the way, we didn't seat you in that seat today to show you your rebellion, though it can. There's a whole nother purpose in it. We really believe that sometimes because in life we've missed, we want to isolate ourselves from other people. I'm one of the world's best at it. And isolation leads to devastation. And church isn't about hiding from one another. Church is really about encouraging one another, coming together and begin to do life with one another and build each other up in who Christ Jesus says. And so we thought it would just be a really cool deal to put you closer together so you make you get to know somebody around you that you don't know. And you're like, I don't want to know anybody else. Here's the good news is the deal is that, you know, maybe because you get to know somebody you're sitting beside that you don't know. And, you know, is maybe that's the blessing you're really looking for. The Bible says his ways are higher than our ways. Maybe that person you sitting by today, you didn't know them when you walked in, but you said, hello, what's your New Year's resolution? And they told you something. And maybe that person's going to give you the next job that you've really been looking for all of your life. But, hey, I want to do it my way, really. Maybe you're one of those sweet guys in here today that, you know, has a loving heart and you want that special woman or sweet woman that wants that special guy. And you're like, man, I want to sit over. Look, you're not going to meet the person unless you do community and life together. You gotta get connected. And I know sometimes it's uncomfortable. But isolation can lead to devastation. And God didn't design us to be isolated from one another. He actually designed us to do life with one another. So we thought this would just be a creative way to get us to begin to do that. And second and foremost, it prepares us for where we're going here in the future, because we're going to have to fill every seat because of what God is doing through this community in the life of this church. And so, man, thank you for doing that today and going along with the plan. And if God shows you you're rebellious, maybe just repent of your sin today and, you know, you can begin to hit the ball out of the park. I just wanted to share that with you today. But back to the sermon. You know, there's three primary ways that we can basically begin to hit the ball out of the park. Grace is established in our life so that we can keep growing and keep learning. God doesn't want you just to be forgiven. He wants to coach you to greatness. Listen to how Titus chapter 2 puts it. It says, for the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. His name is Jesus. God's grace teaches us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age, looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people, zealous for good works. His own special people purify us, coach us. He creates his own special people so that we can begin to hit some hole-in-ones in life. So I need you to understand, God don't only want you to be positioned right, he wants you to function right. And the only way to function right is to keep being a recipient of God's favor and God's grace. And the only way to continue to be a recipient of God's favor and God's grace is to be in community with God and access him daily along life's journey and let him tell you which club to pull out every time you miss so you can continue to improve in life. So there's three basic lessons from the game of golf I want to give us today in order to do that. And the first one is this, is if you're gonna really hit some good shots, the first thing you gotta do is loosen up. Loosen up. You know, a stiff golfer can't really do much with the ball. Loosen up, you know? Look at your neighbor, say, loosen up. Tell them to loosen up. Tell them to loosen up. Come on. Loosen up. You know what's amazing? Is there was a guy in the Bible in Acts chapter 7, and he looked at a bunch of people that they were so focused on the structure, they had no movement in their life. In the game of golf, you don't only have structure, you gotta have movement. It takes both. Not just movement, not just structure. You gotta have structure to guide your movement, but you gotta have movement in order to really hit the ball well. Well, these people in life, they had structure. They had the law in their life, but the law wasn't moving them in such a way to know who Christ is so that they could put their faith in him and be coached by God's Spirit forever and ever and ever. And in Acts 7, Peter looks at them and basically calls them. He says, you're a bunch of stiff-necked people. You're stiff. And can I tell you, he wasn't saying that to be mean. He was saying that to help them understand. All you're doing is focusing on the structure. And I need you to understand, the structure wants to cause movement in your life. And you're stiff. You're not loose. And what's going to happen is all you do is stiffen up. You're never going to swing the club right because the structure is designed for you to be able to swing properly, but it's also designed for you to be able to move properly. And what some of us need to do today is loosen up. Understand, you can never be made right by the law of God. It doesn't mean the structure is bad, but you gotta understand the purpose of the structure is to show you how awesome and perfect God is. And it doesn't mean that you don't try to win and begin to have perfection in your life, but it makes you realize you can't achieve it without him. And you need to put your faith in what the law pointed to. And Jesus says, I didn't come to abolish the law. I actually came to fulfill the law. I'm what it pointed to. And if you'll come alongside of me, you know what? I'll position you right, and then I'll begin to help you function right. And so many of us are not functional because we've listened to Jesus and we've believed in him to position us right, but what we're not doing is we're not allowing him to help us function properly because we're so uptight with the structure that we're missing the significance of the structure. Let me give you an example today. Communion. Communion is where we call it the Lord's Supper, the Eucharist, however you want to phrase that word. Some of us are more worried about what we call it than what it is. Some of us are more worried about how we take it, whether, you know, what do we do with the cup and how we take it and how we administrate it than what it represents. See, and if you're so focused on the structure with communion in church, you miss its purpose. And I want you to understand why Jesus said to do it from now on. Because you can have the structure right, but miss the meaning of it, and you won't have any significant movement in your life. Communion, Jesus said, is to remember him. Remember that he gave his body on a cross, and he shed his blood, and he created a new covenant, a new agreement called grace with human beings. And every time you drink this cup, remember the covenant of grace and Jesus' blood poured out so God could forgive you of your sins and you can move forward. But it's not about the structure. It's about the purpose of the structure. Oh, yeah. But some of us are more focused on, did I do that right? Did I open the cup right? Did I pour the right kind of juice in it? Did I eat the cracker right? My friends, it's great to do all of that in reverence, but you can be as reverent and stiff-necked as you want to be and miss the purpose of it. And it never creates movement in your life to do what God has designed you to do. Loosen up. It's okay. Yes, we are to take communion on a regular basis to remember who Jesus is in this new covenant of grace where we have full access to God. But so many people were caught up in the stiff-neckedness of the structure. I want to read to you what Jesus told them in Matthew 11. He says this. Jesus says, come to me. Come to me, all of you who are weary and carrying heavy burdens. The people were putting such heavy burdens on the people that they felt like they had to follow the structure versus what the structure was about. And Jesus says this. He says, come to me. He says, I will give you rest. He says, team up with me. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you because I am humble and gentle at heart and you will find rest for your souls. For he says, my way, my yoke, teamed up with me is easy to bear and the burden I give you is light. In other words, I'm not going to just put things on you. So so that, you know, that you can't do it and I can point my finger at you. I'm going to teach you in such a way that you become better at the game of life. You swing the club better. You accomplish more. And he says, then you're going to begin to move the ball down the field. You're going to begin to do something significant with your life. I'm going to teach you in such a way that when you put your faith in me, I'm going to come alongside of you. And, you know, it's not about the structure, but I do keep the structure, but I have a way to teach you about what the structure is all about. It's amazing. Some of us need to loosen up. Some of us came here today stiff-necked. And we're more worried sometimes about what we wore or what we didn't wear and those kind of things. And I just want to communicate to you today, God is like, what does all that stuff represent? You need to understand that first and foremost. Does it make it bad about any of us? But we have to loosen up if we want to hit some holy ones. Number two is this, is I wrote it down this way. We have to listen up. Listen up. It's one thing to be loose and let God begin to show you you're positionally right and you can begin to play the game. But listening is the key. Listening to God. And really, that's what fasting is all about, is drawing closer to God so we can listen up and become everything he's created us to be. And many of us have heard the good news about Jesus has come, gave his life on a cross, resurrected from a grave. But do you know, after you have been positioned right with him, that God still wants to tell you which clubs to pull out of the bag in certain scenarios so you can begin to hit the ball well? That's what God does. His word is full of great clubs. His word is a bag of clubs. It tells you how to be positionally right with God. It tells you who God is. It tells you who you are. And there's principles in there that are significant that says, you know, things like, hey, you know what, you want a great marriage, then pull out, you know, maybe he's telling my wife this. I need you to pull out the putter, and I need you to be gentle with him if you want to have a great marriage. This is how God's word works. But this is what we do. Instead of listening to what God's word says and getting the putter out, you're like, God, I know I'm positionally right with you, but I know more about him than you know about him. So I'm going to not do what your word says. And instead of getting the putter out and being gentle with him, you know what he really needs is a driver. And I'm going to take care of him. See, listening to God means understanding his word and begin to really apply it to the situation. And it may not feel right to pull out the putter. But if you want to change maybe your marriage, maybe just try it on for a season. And it's actually what changed my wife's and mine's marriage. Because she still gets the driver out sometimes. But she was getting the driver out, and God spoke to her heart. And she pulled the putter out. And I began to see the gentleness and love of Jesus in somebody like I'd never seen it before. Undeserved kindness, undeserved grace. And can I tell you something? She did exactly what the Bible said. She was a wife with an unbelieving husband that won his heart by her love and her grace and her mercy and her gentleness. And you know what? What happened was I was drew to Christ, and many, many thousands of lives have been changed because she chose to put the club down and pick up the one that God says pick up. It works this way in every area of your life. You say, man, I want some finances. I'm getting my driver out. I'm going to knock it out of the park. And God's like, oh, no, 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 no. Get out the six iron. I don't like the six iron. I know better than you, God. See, this is how we do it. And God's word is a bag of clubs, and it's full of good things to coach you and teach you all the way along the journey, in the sand traps, you know, when you're in the woods, wherever it's at. And if you'll take and get positioned right with Christ, and then begin to let the Spirit of God nurture you and minister you, and you begin to listen up, things begin to change, and you begin to make progress, and you're like, oh, shoot, I'm going to listen a little bit more, because I know I didn't feel like pulling the putter out, but when I pulled the putter out and I did what God said and I did it consistently, guess what? Things changed. Maybe his ways are higher than my ways. Maybe he knows more than I know. Maybe he is the creator. I'm the creation. Maybe he's right. And you know what? I need to come underneath his submission. But what happens a lot of times is old rebellious nature kicks in. I got this. See, I'm telling, the key is trust God and come underneath his authority and begin to let him coach you to greatness. I know sometimes it goes against what you feel, but my friend, he is perfect every single time. He delivers on his promises over and over and over again. So don't only loosen up and listen up. I need you to swing the club. Swing the club. Take action. Because if you want to get better at the game of life, it's one thing to sit in here today and get a little loosened up. It's one thing to listen up and know which club to pull out of the bag. Takes it to another level when you do what it says, pull it out of the bag and swing it. Good things begin to happen. And the challenge with some of us, we look at God as a far-off God, not a personal God that's with us, walking alongside of us and helping us achieve perfection. And he's like the most amazing golf coach in the world, and he's never going to laugh at you or poke fun at you. All he's trying to do is to help you elevate to what he's created you to be. And don't be afraid of him. Respect him, but don't be afraid of him. I mean, don't give him the Heisman. I mean, don't be like, I got this, God. Come on. I mean, honestly, hear him, man. Hear what he says in his word. Let it speak into your heart. And you get in a situation and just begin to practice it. And like, God, this club just don't feel right. And he's like, just adjust it that way. Just do that. Just a stance this way. Do that. I'm telling you, man, he'll begin to speak into your heart in such a powerful way. But you've got to do something with it all. The Bible says in 2 Timothy that God's word is there to teach us. It's not there just to save us. But we've got to swing the club. I want you to listen to what James chapter 1 says. It says, don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says. Otherwise, you are only fooling yourselves. Don't know a six iron does this. Do something with it. He says, for if you listen to the word and don't obey it, it's like glancing at your face in a mirror. You see yourself, you walk away, you forget what you look like. But if you look carefully into the perfect law that sets you free, and if you do what it says and don't forget what you heard, then God blesses you for doing it. Action plan. Action plan. Take action with what God's word says. Pull out the club on the whole. Do what he asks you to do. You know, and again, it may feel uncomfortable, but as you begin to do it, you're going to begin to succeed. So it's not only about you know, just loosening up. It's loosening up, being positioned right with Christ, listening to the Spirit of God speaking into your heart, and then doing what he says. And here's the good news. Even if you're, you know, trying to be attentive to him and do what he says, and you do get air on the ball occasionally, he's going to gently coach you how to get it right and begin to hit the ball out of the park. Your purpose in life is to do great things for the kingdom of God and shed light on this world who does not know God. And my friends, the way we do that is get positioned right in Jesus Christ and then listen to God's Spirit coach us daily and change the world around us as we become better at life, then people begin to ask you about the answer for the hope that you have inside of you. And you say, well, I got positioned right by Jesus and I walk with him. I'm not perfect, but I am walking with perfection, and some things are getting out of my life and some new things are getting in my life, and I'm knocking the ball out of the park. You want to know how I'm winning? I got God. I'm walking by his principles. I'm walking in his purpose. I'm doing what he's designed me to do. Wow. It's okay to clap. That's fantastic. Praise God. And you know, so what I want to do today is I want to kind of close with this idea, because some of us are at a crossroads today. And, you know, we may not know which path to take. And I just want to encourage you today, because it's more to life and fulfilling your purpose than just letting God make you righteous because of the blood of Jesus. He makes you righteous. The Bible says he makes you right because of the blood of Jesus. But the Bible says he saves you and gives you a set apart calling. That word calling basically means this. That's kind of a Christian word we like to use. What's your calling, bro? What's your calling, ma'am? Listen, that's a great word, but here's what it simply means. God saves you and gives you a unique assignment. And my friends, what begins to flow out of your life when you are doing what, it doesn't mean you don't have challenges, roadblocks and all that kind of stuff, but what begins to flow out of your life whenever you're in the sweet spot of God's success, you've been positioned right by Jesus and you're listening to his purpose. But what happens in your life is some things begin to flow out of you, and those things are called joy. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. The Bible says that is the fruit of the Spirit. So if you're not experiencing that today, maybe you need to recalibrate. Maybe you need to refocus. Maybe you need to get positioned right, or maybe you just need to not only be positioned right, maybe you've been positioned right, you need to start listening to God better and pulling out the club he tells you to pull out and follow his coaching. But I'm going to close with this, because some of us are at a crossroads today. Proverbs 3, verses 5 through 10. This is what the scripture says in the wisdom book of Proverbs. It says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart, and do not depend upon your own understanding. In other words, trust what God says over what you feel. His way is higher than your way. It says, seek his will in all you do, and he will show you which path to take. Which club to pull out? It says, don't be impressed with your own wisdom. I got this, God. With your worldly wisdom, it says, instead, fear the Lord, respect the Lord, and turn away from evil. And then you will have healing for your body and strength for your bones. Does anybody need healing and strength today? The Bible says this. The Bible says it comes by trusting who God is and not trusting by what I feel. It comes by picking up the clubs he says to pick up and swing at life, not coming by what I think with my worldly wisdom today. He says, honor the Lord. Everybody say honor. 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 Honor the Lord with your wealth. And with the best part of everything, the best part of everything you produce, the best part of everything, give it all you got, the best part of everything that you produce, honor God with it. Wow. And look what it says. It says, then he will fill your barns, your life, with grain, with the spiritual things that you need. And your vats will overflow with good wine. your life will overflow with joy, with His Spirit. Anytime you see this word wine in Scripture, it typically represents the Spirit of God and the joy the Spirit of God produces out of someone's life. And the Bible says you want that joy to flow out of your life. You want that joy to overflow out of your life. It says get in the sweet spot of God's success. Let Him position you rightly. Begin to listen attentively to what He says. Swing the club. Advance. Do amazing things. And He says honor Him in all aspects of your life. Give, be generous, pray, talk to God, fast. You know what? Seek God with all of your heart, and He's going to begin to do the amazing in your life. And I do believe that God is proposing to some of us today to let the joy flow out of us. You know, I've been pastoring now for about how long, Kim? 13 years, something like that. And I can tell you right now, there's been ups and downs. But I got more joy in ministry right now than I have ever had in my life. It doesn't mean my life is without challenges, but my friends, I'm telling you right now, I got so much joy in my heart because I know my position. And it took me a long time to not just understand I am positioned right with God, but then to understand that He's created me for a purpose and no one can thwart His plan for my life. All I've got to do is walk in it every single day. And you know, the thing is, if people laugh at me when I miss the ball, I'm okay with that because God looks at me and He says, I created you for this time and this place to be this part, and you keep swinging the club, and you keep swinging the club, and you keep swinging the club, and you know what? Joy is going to be produced out of your life over and over. Sir, I want to talk to you today. I need you to keep swinging the club. I know it's difficult sometimes, but keep listening to God. Let the Spirit of God speak into your heart and let your heart overflow with His joy. Our purpose is to work together for a common cause, and it's to build the kingdom and advance His purpose in the earth. And you know what? Hope will rise up not only in us, but it'll also rise up in the world. I do believe we can sink the shot and make some hole-in-ones if we loosen up, listen up, take a swing, and expect God to produce something amazing out of our life. Can you bow your heads, please? God, You're an amazing God. Thank You for every sweet soul here today. And God, you brought some people here today to speak encouragement into them, to speak life into them. So God, I want to pray for every man, every woman, every boy, and every girl. God, You set an appointment with some folks in here today. You put them in the seat they're in so they could understand, because they're tired and worn out, God, that they don't have to keep trying harder. All they need to do is trust what You've already done. My friend, if that is you today, that's what believing in the cross and the blood of Jesus and the resurrection Jesus is all about. It's about you taking your faith and putting it in the gift that God offered. Jesus was a gift. None of us deserve Him. We've all gone our own way. We've all missed the mark, but God didn't want us to live life in that way. So He came to give us a position. He came to play best ball. He came to let us move our life to where the perfect one's life is and be righteous because He is righteous. My friends, if your life today is depending on what you do instead of what He does, I just invite you today to take that faith you have and maybe right where you sit today, talk to your Creator and say, God, I'm tired of doing it my way. And today I want to learn. I want to learn from You. God, I want to receive the position that Jesus came to give me when He came to pay a high price on a cross and give His life. God, He positioned me in right standing with You because of His perfect blood that was shed. Just tell God something like that and say, God, I want to move my life and I want to put my faith and trust in what He's done instead of what I do. Just tell God today you believe, you trust. Tell God you believe that Jesus conquered death, conquered your sin, conquered the grave, and you put your faith in that He is more than a conqueror, and that you are too because of what He's done. You believe with all of your heart in his resurrection today. The Bible says if we confess with our mouth and believe in our heart that Jesus resurrected from the grave, in that moment, we're made right with God. We're saved. And so today, maybe that's the decision you need to make. And if you just said that prayer, I want to simply say to you, welcome to the family of God. God's done an amazing work in your life today. He brought you here so you could be positioned right. For those of us today who have been positioned right with Christ, I want to speak to you today and just want to pray for you. Maybe you're tired of just struggling and doing life your way and pulling out your own clubs and not really being submitted to God. I pray today that you would turn your heart towards him and realize he didn't only make you right by what he did on the cross, but he begins to give you his incredible spirit, and his spirit can fill you full of joy as you submit to his authority. God is an amazing God. He is for you and not against you, my friends. He wants you to succeed. He wants you to be the best you can possibly be. And the only way to be the best you is to submit to his authority and let him begin to show you and coach you to what he's created you to do and where he's created to place you. I pray today, God, for all of these people, for us to have a submitted spirit and, God, be in the sweet spot of your success. And 2017 be like no year ever, God, as we come to you and we as a church begin to move your vision, your purpose forward, because we're going to be a people that worship you and a people that submit to you and give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Can you give God a big hand clap in this place today? God bless you.